Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
Hello, everyone. Welcome again to Berks Perspectives. As always, we are thrilled to have you with us. I am in lovely downtown Reading, and the other slackers are sitting in their family rooms or wherever, but we're here to have our conversation, our weekly conversation. We have with us John Forrester.
Hello, everybody.
And Martha Richardson.
Hi.
Ruth Martelli.
Hi.
And hi. Fredo Belinsky.
Good to be here.
Oh, he's practicing for Broadway. And I am still, last I checked, Fred Levering. So here we go. I wanted to open up with some local stuff. I saw something there and talked to a few people about it. Talked to Senator Judy Schwenk, who was involved in helping secure some financing and stuff. But there is, given our current circumstances out there and controversies with shortages, a new baby formula plant now in operation in Exeter Township. That's a cool thing. I mean, there are, when you think about how ubiquitous baby formula is, there are only a couple of companies that make the stuff. And when one of them has a problem, as we've recently experienced, it really can form a bottleneck. And now we have a new one. Now this new one will be producing a fraction of what those big people do, but it's right here in our backyard. And I spoke with Judy Schwenk, as I mentioned, who was involved in securing some state financing for them. And then actually was able to get a second grant. She's very excited about the whole thing. She has a farming background where she was involved in some of those kind of things. And the idea that this is being produced locally is really neat. So I don't know what the source of the milk that they use is. I hope it's a local source. Although she did tell me that it's kind of an organic thing. So I don't know if the local plants like Clover Farms are able to produce that sort of milk or not. But for us in Berks County to have this in our backyard is neat. So did you all see that?
Can I say something that's a little, I think it's wonderful that we have that. Maybe after the show, I think it was 2 weeks ago that we were talking about this, and Fred, you said you remembered your mother making formula with Cairo, which of course we know Cairo is corn syrup and not particularly healthy, but it was just a tiny bit of Cairo that they used. But I started thinking about this, and I would bet that all five of us probably were raised on Cairo, unless we were nursed through, you know, toddlerhood. And here we are, and here we are in this age with our infant mortality rate in this country is not something to be very proud of compared to the Western nations. It made me wonder why, when this happened with the shortage of formulas, that the American Medical Society or the Pediatric Society or some group that would have known didn't come out with emergency measures for young parents to use to make their own formula. And it made me wonder just how much of a political pressure was put on groups not to do that, so that the formulas would not use, the formula companies wouldn't lose business. I know that it sounds like a grouchy old lady finding something negative in a positive local issue.
I had this exactly the same question. I mean, I understand some of these issues related to children who were not tolerant to cow's milk, you know, had special things. That
right.
Yet. But for the vast majority of babies, surely there was an alternative to starving.
How many of your grade school friends died of peanut butter allergies?
Well, I don't know of any, but I know
none. Right, but surely pediatricians, pediatric nurses, obstetrical clinics must have a formula that they could give to parents to have used during this time. And it really made me doubt the influence of politics or question the influence of politics on the fact that that wasn't done.
Yeah, no doubt in my mind that my mother's recipe, which I remember her using with my sister, mixing up the formula, it would not have been optimal, or would not even have been desirable. But again, considering the alternative, which is nothing on the shelf, surely there's something that's safe that could have been prescribed that would get us through.
I looked online and I saw there are dozens and dozens of sites with formula information to make your own. And most of them say, don't use this. Most of them are based in evaporated milk at K-Rock. They may not have been optimal, but you know, how do we know these formulas that people are using? You know, what kind of water are they using? Many of them have to be mixed with water. What kind of water are they using to mix them? It just surprised me that we are not better equipped to handle emergencies like that.
You know, I'd like to redirect this a little bit. I mean, yeah, okay, we may have a problem with the formula and everything, but I'd like to know how the machinations of how this plant was attracted to Berks County. Was it the Berks County community? I'm sorry, what's the name of the Economic Development Authority? Or did Judy Schwenk have a job in this? I know Judy Schwenk has taken Mike Opaque's seat, and I think she's done a wonderful job at it. She's nonpartisan. She's not an ideological Democrat. She's a Berks County advocate, as was Opaque, and who I knew from his the beginning of his political career. I think I'd like to know how this was attracted to Berks.
That's interesting. I think it was kind of spontaneous. I know that's probably not the right word, but it was just somebody that had an idea, and it's a woman, as I recall from the articles that I read, that is running, or at least the head of the operation. And I think she just decided that this is something that became a passion of hers. And then people like Senator Schwenk and perhaps the economic development arm of the chamber and so on, then, you know, were, you know, very willing to step up and lend a hand. But I think it was pretty much self-initiated.
I wonder also if it didn't come from a formula that she was mixing herself to use for her own children instead of like formula.
I don't know.
Whatever happened to the Berks County Economic Development Authority? Ed Sawyer's old.
Yeah, well, that's still in operation, and has
quietly
new leadership, and it's been folded into the overarching. I keep referring to it as the chamber, but the chamber is part of the Greater Reading advocacy, there's some name for it. I'm sorry, I'm acting stupid here that I don't know it. I should, because I'm involved with it. But it's part of that, and they're still very active. They've been behind like the organization and then the financing and stuff for things like the industrial parks where some of these enormous warehouses have been built. They did the one up on Route 78 near Bethel, and now they're presently working on the one out on 183 in Burn Township near the airport. So they spend a lot of their time on those things, but they do lend a hand. And I've met with them from the standpoint of seeking grant funding and so on as part of our knitting mills project in Wyomissing. I'm trying to get a group together, or whatever you'd call it, to build a bridge over the railroad to extend 8th Avenue up into the area where the medical school now is, tie it together. But in any event, they're still active, John.
Okay.
They didn't go away.
They're just very quiet.
Well, sometimes that's a good thing. There's, you know, but they certainly are very active and well respected, I think. Some other stuff locally here. We've talked about Tower Health and some of their problems over the recent couple of years. They had decided to sell those two units, those two hospitals in Chester County, one of which was at Jennersville, and there's now a buyer for it. That has been pulled out of the fire where it was to close. I guess it did close, in fact. And now a medical organization from, I believe they're from Delaware County, or even Delaware.
Delaware.
Has picked up and is in the process of redoing, getting it up and running again. So I'm glad for the folks in Chester County and that area down that far in Chester County to have a facility nearby again. So that's, I guess they had to go all the way up to Westchester or something previously. So that is, I think, good news for the region. John and I chatted a little bit about this, and it was kind of a subject that he had some interesting memories of, but we're fast approaching, I think it was this 19th of June when Hurricane Agnes hit land or whatever.
And,
22nd by the time it got here, I guess it was, but it hit, I think, in Florida on the 19th. Right. And so this is the 50th, I'm sorry to say, the 50th anniversary of Hurricane Agnes, or I guess what was technically Tropical Storm Agnes, but will live forever in our minds as Hurricane Agnes, hit Berks County. And, the stuff that happened, and John was relating some stories from the newspaper side of covering the event and stuff. I'm sitting here at approximately the corner of 4th and Penn. The waters came up off the Schuylkill River as far as 2nd Street, I think. And I remember my dad's plumbing business got somehow hired, and I was just out of college, so I was part of it, of the cleanup, which was just incredible. The city set up a dump down on Canal Street or something like that, and that's where I learned how to drive a stick shift dump truck, hauling things down as he loaded it up with tobacco. And there were cans of Budweiser everywhere. I mean, Northeast Distributors used to be right by the Penn Street Bridge.
And I was there when it went under.
Cans all over the place. It was unbelievable. So John, talk about it a little bit.
We were down by the river. First of all, we went down 4th Street, we went south on 4th Street from the paper. Of course, this is after hours. And the police had blockaded the street at Franklin Street. Well, Nick Yost was the driver of our car at that time. And he pulled up very slowly to the fire policeman and rolled down the window, and the fire policeman came by and went to lean on the car, and Nick floored it. So we went right through all the blockades, went down by the river, and Northeast Distributors was north of Penn Street on the running side of the river, and there were a whole bunch of people along the river fishing out six packs if they could, and we saw one guy riding a keg like a horse down the river.
Well, I'll tell you, did they crack open any of those cans and drink them?
Oh yeah, they did.
Man, I'd be nervous about that. I remember as we
the
were
the smell of fuel oil in the air was
you bet. I remember finding a Coleman cooler that was locked shut, and in the cooler it was filled with water, and there was a thermos bottle, and I opened that thermos, unscrewed the cap, and poured mud out of it. I mean, I know how the heck did that get in there, but it did. That was a remarkable thing. Martha, Ruth, any thoughts about the Agnes?
Yeah, I actually My father had just come home from the hospital after probably his fifth heart attack. He was really ill. And I'm smiling because it is a funny story. I came home from Italy because he was in really bad shape, but he had come home from the hospital the day before the hurricane struck. And my parents lived in a big old house in Mühlberg Park and had a French drain in the cellar. They also had a basement filled with stuff that they had collected, you know, furniture, all kinds of stuff from both families. And so my father was sitting in the living room on his chair, like hoping he wasn't going to die. I'm pretty sure he thought he was going to, just breathing. And the water was coming into our basement up through the French drain. My mother would open the door and look down, and she said to me, "Don't tell him, he'll be so upset because it's all his family's stuff down there. Just don't tell him, just, you know." And he would say, "How's the water in the basement?" Because they had a little trickle sometimes. And she said, "It's fine, it's fine." And so all day, occasionally there would be a bump, and he would say, because things started to float. And he would say, "Is there okay?" And she'd open the door and she'd say to me, "It's on the third step." And she'd say, "It's fine, it's fine down there, it's dry." So this just went on and on, and she said it was in the fifth step. And finally, I mean, my mother was a wreck. She was so afraid. He was gonna die of shock. And I don't think he moved all day from his chair. And finally, about 5 o'clock, she couldn't take it anymore. And she opened the door and he said, "I hear things bumping down there. Are you sure it's okay?" My mother, who never swore, said, "Gosh darn it. It's up to the third store and we're storage step and we've lost everything." And he didn't die. it was a stressful day for my family.
Ruth, were you around at that time?
I wasn't here. I was, what year? I forget.
72.
72.
I was teaching in Philadelphia, so I wasn't in the area. I don't remember if Philly had any damage or not. I sort of don't think so.
No, they had to get a lot of water down the Schuylkill, so.
Maybe, I don't remember it.
The fire company's son came around and pumped out the cellars from my mother's house and all the houses around them because they all had problems.
From a sociological standpoint, that event really changed Reading.
You bet.
More than any other event in history. It tore up neighborhoods. It brought the Army Corps of Engineers in, and they just moved people around, and we had neighborhoods that were predominantly Black, predominantly Polish, predominantly Spanish-speaking, predominantly Italian, Greek. I could Polish. I could tell you, you know, by your last name, where you lived, and that just like moved everybody around,
yeah.
And it kind of tore the fabric of the city sociologically, and it's never been the same.
That's really a very interesting thought about disrupting the neighborhoods like that, you know, which were all ethnic. Go ahead.
When we moved into our home on 4th Street, our neighbors had been resettled into an apartment building on our block because they lived on River Road and lost everything. And Mary was Italian, her husband was, she called him a hunky, so I don't know what he was, something. What do you call Slavic?
Slavic.
Yeah. But yes, they were displaced people.
Yeah.
And a lot of displaced people with whole neighborhoods completely submerged and had to be destroyed.
And
so you're right, John.
famously, the Sixth Ward was absolutely inundated, and that was a very cohesive Black neighborhood, and they had their institutions that kept it cohesive, and they were peppered throughout all the other communities, and I don't think it was forced integration. And you know, I'm not saying I'm for segregation, but I am for a cohesive, homogeneous neighborhood, and this forced people into accepting people who weren't like themselves, and it just destroyed neighborhoods.
Yeah, that's you know, really a fascinating idea. I mean, that should be studied if it hasn't been. As a real estate guy, I've long thought that people's basic tendency is always to live with people that are similar to themselves, and that hurricane disrupted them. Yeah.
Well, and they were built around the churches too.
Mm, that's right.
For instance, the Polish community was centered around St. Mary's. St. Paul's was the Italian church.
Holy Rosary was, yes.
But St. Mary's was in the southeast section of the city, mm-hmm. around Cotton Street and
South 15th and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, that area, and then there was the Greek. Constantine and Helen Church, which was on South 6th Street, and that was kind of the Greek community, mm-hmm. and you know, then you're right, you had Holy Rosary, which was a Southwest community, part of this. So I mean, it was you could almost tell where people were from by their last names.
Yeah. Fred, where were you with
this? I was on internship in Knoxville, Tennessee. So I missed all of the fun. I was going to school in Gettysburg and left boxes of books with friends who were staying there for that year, and they got destroyed in the basement of those folks in Gettysburg.
Yeah. As a meteorological thing, the hurricane came up through the Chesapeake, as most of our bad weather does, and it dumped a lot of rain in our area. And it had been a very rainy spring, and so the ground was saturated. And then it went up north and got up into northern Pennsylvania, up above Scranton, Wilkes-Barre, and so on, and stalled. And it just sat there for several days. Raining buckets, and that all came, you know, water flows downhill, and it all ended up back down here. I mean,
yeah,
it was
the in Scranton Wilkes-Barre area was devastated,
right?
And their congressman, Representative Flood,
that's right,
Dan Flood was very instrumental in getting them a lot of aid.
Boscov, big time. Didn't he swoop in and rescue the downtown, the heart of Wilkes-Barre? I think.
That was later, though.
Yeah, that was. But just for anybody that cares, I mean, it was a big deal. Was Blue Marsh Lake did not exist. That was built after this, and the claim is
a plan before,
and they claim, I've read that the Blue Marsh Lake today, had that been in place, would have reduced the flood stage in down here in Reading by 20 feet. I mean, so the devastation down here in this area where I am on off of Penn is would have been remarkably different had that dam had been built then. But so it's interesting reminiscing, but to move on.
Can I just go back to the to what you're talking about, the neighborhoods? John, you just talked about the neighborhoods. You grew up in them and you know where they were. So we're not talking ancient history here. And we have a mutual friend, but George Hatzo, who has amazing stories to tell about growing up Greek in Berks County. And
George grew up in Penn side.
Right, but he traveled into the city twice a week to go to Greek school. I just think it would be really interesting for some of you people who experienced this to get together and write it down so that people could see what Reading was like when it had those neighborhoods and really know that it wasn't just 200 years ago that they existed, but that it was a whole different city at that time. And there are interesting stories to be told because of some of the neighborhoods and the things that went on. And you're right, they were based on the churches in many cases. Just a suggestion with some of you who are retired and have the talent to write it.
Well, that would be more up John's alley than
I have no talent.
Come on, right?
Well,
just
some other
looks like
things.
Instead on arrival.
I left my talent at the office.
Right. You and George.
Well, it's just half a block from me. I'll check if it's still there, John.
George and I were friends. We grew up in the same neighborhood.
Really?
Yeah.
Now, let's talk about a couple of modern things here. The city is announced that they are looking to hire, I don't know what the time frame is, but hired 42. That's with a 4 in front of it. 42 new police officers. They are way low now, and this is, I think, would be a heck of a step forward. Now, how exactly that's going to be paid for, I can't tell you. I mean, these federal money that's flowing out of D.C. into the various cities and towns has a shelf life. It ain't going to continue. So, but hiring that kind of a number, I don't know what the numbers are here, but I know in Wyomissing Borough, when we hire, we're very careful about it because we know we're making a commitment to that officer for about $500,000 between salary and benefits and all that stuff. So you're really putting the community on the hook for a lot of money. So you multiply that by 42. It's a remarkable commitment, but boy, I think that would make a big difference.
Okay, I just have to say this because I've dealt with the Reading Police Department since 1969, right? And I knew most of the cops, the 200 cops that they had on the force, and they hired from within not only within the community, the county, within the city, and the force was very effective because of that. The cops knew the community. They lived in the community, and now they don't. They are hiring professionals. I stop myself from saying mercenaries, but you know, they don't know the community. They don't know their neighbors. They don't know who the good guys are and who the bad guys are and who are just the kind of goof-offs that get in trouble every once in a while and shouldn't necessarily be thrown in jail. I think that's important that they look within the community for cops that know the community and represent their community. Otherwise, you get things like like we saw last summer.
Ruth, you were going to say something?
No, I think John's absolutely right. But there are people who don't think that that's really important, that knowing your community isn't, doesn't make it safer. It's having a, you know, having weaponry and armor and all that kind of stuff that makes a community safe. I think John's on the right track. It's employing people who know and care about the citizens that they're supposed to be policing.
I think it's got to be more than just a job. You need to have a heart for the people that you're serving. And I think that that verb I chose intentionally because it is a matter of service to the community. And let's hope they get the right folks in and that it's going to go well. I mean, obviously, we need to have more people on the force. I don't know what could possibly be done, for example, in the school system to engender that desire in the students so that when they graduate from high school, that's the direction they want to go. I think we'd be better served in that regard. But it is, I think that is really important as well.
Well, public service, generally speaking, has been somewhat tarnished over the last little while because a lot of public servants aren't really public servants any longer.
Well, that segues me nicely to the next line I had here. And we have to acknowledge the unfortunate and very untimely, unexpected passing of Jeff Waltman, 58 years old. So, I mean, I don't know, and I shouldn't even say this, but I've been dumb before, probably a heart issue or something like that, to have something that unexpectedly and sudden, but because he was not ill, to my knowledge. He was on the job. But he dedicated himself. He was, 22 years that he served on council, a good chunk of it as council president. It's a really unfortunate thing. And losing that volume of institutional knowledge is going to really be noticeable. Fortunately, we have some other folks on council like Donna Reed and Hinderschitz Goodman, so a couple of others that have been there a while, and therefore will be able to continue that to some degree. But I was very saddened to see that happen. Any thoughts, panel?
Yeah, I don't know him at all, but what struck me just from reading the articles in the newspaper about council meetings and decisions and so on was that he seemed to be a real, the best kind of leader in that. They're obviously in a group like that going to be disparate.
I'm on the TV show.
Disparate opinions, but I think he had respect for everybody, and I think they respected him. And because of that, there seemed to be very little brouhaha at council meetings under his leadership. You know, he seemed to be a conciliatory sort of person, and the sort of leader that valued all, and that helps the group to be productive.
Yeah, I knew Jeff. Not that I covered him, because he was on council when I was when I had become an editor, and I wasn't out in the streets anymore or covering council meetings. However, he used to come into the peanut bar after council meetings, and you know that's where we debriefed every night. And Jeff was very serious. He knew the community. He cared for the community very, very much, and all aspects of the city. I think when I read that he had died, I guessed, only because I consider him one of the great leaders of Reading since the 2000s.
I'd have to agree with that, although I will add though, John, that executive sessions at a watering hole after a council meeting is not an entirely unusual thing, I can attest to. But
we didn't exclude anybody.
All right, we've talked a good bit about some local things, which I'm glad to do, because that's really, I think, what a lot of our basis is. But there are some things heading down the 95 to the DC and elsewhere. The January 6th thing, there were hearings going on, I guess, right now. And a couple of you said you were watching them before we started our program. Any late breaking thoughts? I mean, there was a meeting that was supposed to be on TV last night that was canceled. I don't know why.
It was postponed
so they could get to the visual aids together, the tapes and things in order.
The proverbial technical issues. All right, that's good.
Right.
One of the lots of things that struck me, but I think most powerfully, is how their testimony has been almost exclusively from Republicans. And those Republicans, many of them from the White House, many of them on Trump's election team and elsewhere, all have borne witness to the fact that all roads lead to Trump in regard to what happened on January 6th, the planning before it, the big lie promotion after it. Trump is not a bystander. Trump is not one who was influenced by others. Trump was calling the shots, setting the things in motion, and then afterward benefiting handsomely from his bogus financial appeals to the tune of $250 million coming into his purse. It is just one atrocious, awful thing after another, and it gives me hope that maybe the truth will triumph.
Although it's sad that even some of the Bill Stepien, for example, who gave that testimony, is currently the campaign manager for a woman who's running against Liz Cheney.
Yeah.
And her entire candidacy is founded on the big lie. So that's still a litmus test, for, even though it's being debunked every day and every witness during the hearings debunks the whole thing. That's still what you have to swear to if you're running as a Republican.
So how in the world how can we have a political party whose main focus is a lie? And we got Mastriano, that's his only claim, running for governor of the state. The big lie, we've got hundreds of people likely to be elected around the country because they promote the big lie, which a dozen people said Trump didn't even believe, but he knew it would be politically and financially expedient for him to promote. I mean, how is this possible? How can you dupe so many people?
Well, how can they continue to be duped? And I remember that Fred L., you said that you would make up your mind as you listened to the hearings. Have you heard anything that made you take pause and think about maybe changing your mind?
Well, I'm still struggling with the conundrum of there is sworn testimony in Congress, I guess it was, or whatever, about that Trump initiated calling the National Guard availability a couple days before the event happened. And it was stonewalled, that it requires concurrence. He can ask for it, but he can't order it. It requires the leader of, turns out to be the House of Representatives, Nancy Pelosi, and the mayor of D.C., Muriel Gillespie.
Bowser.
Thank you. And they both declined.
How did Pence get it? Pence ordered it and they came because Trump did nothing. for those hour after hour.
Yeah, well, that was, I don't know what exactly you're referring to, but that would have been on the spot. I mean, Trump apparently requested to have National Guard troops, like 20,000 of them,
standing by
before his rally ever took place. And they weren't standing by, and therefore took a lot longer to get there. And there's a discrepancy there that I have not been able to reconcile.
I think you're all missing the most important thing that came out.
Which is?
And I'll give you a little background. I knew a guy who worked for the state government and worked for an elected official in the state government, who went to a fundraiser and took a $2,500 donation check home. It was to his boss, and then brought it in and gave it to his election committee the next day. He got 5 years in jail for failing to report an election contribution for 12 hours, okay? Trump has hoodwinked, has grifted $250,000.
A quarter of a billion dollars,
I'm sorry, Fred, to a non-existent committee and failed to report it, the person I was referring to was charged federally with mail fraud and conspiracy. Now, if Trump isn't guilty of mail fraud, wire fraud, conspiracy, and
say nothing of overturning government
and campaign violations, campaign fund violations. I don't think the conspiracy for the insurrection amounts to a hill of beans. This is life imprisonment stuff. That quarter of a billion dollars since he left office.
Right, telling the lie, which is a lie. And the money didn't come. Well, I'm sure some of the money came from people with deep pockets, but a lot of the people were just mom and pop who don't have a lot to start with.
Yeah.
But they gave.
That's fraud. It's wire fraud. It's mail fraud. It's conspiracy. It is a huge crime, and I think we ought to just throw out the hearings and everything else and go after Justice Department. Go after that.
No, there are things turning up in the hearings, if you choose to believe them, that also imply more than Fred was just saying. I mean, these are actual charges, testimony given by the most inner circle that surrounded Trump. And I'm not sure that Bill Barr was right when he said that Trump lost connection to reality. I think he knew what was real, and he knew what he was doing was trying to spin a whole new reality to hoodwink people out of money and get other people to try to keep him in office illegally.
And I don't think they're ever going to go to the president's mouth to say riot. You know, they're not going to pin that riot on him. They're not going to pin the insurrection on him. Maybe a whole bunch of people around him, but I think he's shrewd enough. I was going to say intelligent enough. He's shrewd enough to evade that, pin down to that charge. However, I don't think he's shrewd enough to avoid the fraud charges.
Well, why isn't any of that being talked about?
Well, it is.
I'm sorry.
The last 2 days, 3 days.
Well, they're not talking about it on Fox.
It has been, in fact, what's her name? Zoe Lofgren from California. It called it a scam. I mean, in addition to all the other stuff, he was scamming his constituency to the tune of $250 million.
She said ripping off.
Ripping off.
She actually used ripping off.
And that, I believe that much money came in the week after the insurrection. I mean, it was a matter of a couple of days when Trump had sucked that money up from $10 and $20 contributors all over the country.
This is Bernie Madoff type white collar crime.
But you know, they also know where some of that money went. Don Jr.'s girlfriend, who was in the administration, got $60,000 for a 2-minute introduction to the president, to President Trump, on January 6th at the Ellipse. Some of that money went to his hotels because they're suffering financially as well. So not only do we know that he got that money, we also know where some of that money went. And that's not, evidently, if Fred hasn't heard about that, that's not being talked about in front of people who need to know it. Martha, yeah, I cut you off, Martha. I apologize.
No, you didn't. You didn't cut me off at all. I was only going to say, I wondered who is watching the hearings.
Well, the second hearing was broadcast by Fox, and I was really glad to see them.
Right.
I don't know what prompted it, and I don't know whether they'll continue the hearings, but that group, you know, the first night they refused to broadcast it, and in fact, for the whole length of the hearing, they went commercial free so that their viewers would not be clicking around the channels during the commercials.
But that first hearing, 20 million people listened to.
Sure.
Which is a pretty good chunk of change.
Well, you know, it's truly true. We were talking about servanthood with regard to Jeff Waltman and that sort of thing. What really dismays me is how dozens and dozens of those people from Bill Barr on down or on through knew that Trump was lying, knew that the whole thing regarding election fraud was a farce, and did nothing to stop it, nothing to intervene. They either egged him on, in the case of Rudy Giuliani and the wacko attorney woman, I can't remember her name, Cindy Powell, or they just remained silent until their books were written or until now when they're under subpoena and they tell...
Under oath,
I mean. Imagine the difference that would have made if they had called Trump out when it mattered. And would not allow this untruth to metastasize and so poison the whole Republican Party that lunatics are being elected left and right. I mean, it would have, there was no regard for the country. There was only regard to self, perhaps to preservation, maintaining power, and in the case of Republican office holders, caring more about getting reelected than serving the country or the even preserving our democracy.
Well, and now that the films that are coming, the video that's becoming available about Loudermilk from Georgia, yeah. Representative, sure does look like he was reconnaissing the joint.
Oh my God. And he claims not to know who that guy was, the guy that he was showing around the bowels of the Capitol or the Rayburn Building. Claims that he doesn't know anything about him. Now that's just asinine.
But he just denies and denies and denies. And often.
It's a different story every week. Yeah.
He's not keeping his story straight, is he? And he's only one of many suspected of doing the same thing.
Well, I expect that this story is going to be picking up steam here as these hearings proceed. And we're going to be hearing more things that we can then talk about here. But as we're beginning to wind down, let's look at a couple other things. Has anybody heard anything about when we expect this big abortion ruling out of the Supreme Court that has been hinted at by the leak? Some of the decisions of the court have been coming out in the last couple of days. I haven't heard anything about when this one might finally hit. Has anybody heard anything about that?
Yeah, it has to be before July 1st.
All right. So
yeah, there was speculation that it could come up even during some of the hearings earlier in the week, and that hasn't happened yet. So I think it's imminent.
Well, that was the impression I had as well, Fred. But I haven't heard anything about, all right, well, here, hold onto your hat, here it comes, kind of thing. In the meantime, there was a rather disturbing, I thought, at least, attack planned or whatever for Justice Kavanaugh. There are organizations out there that have been publicizing the justices' home addresses and stuff like that. And this threat was made, and a guy was apparently had second thoughts literally at the last minute. Now, whether he would have gotten very far had he initiated his attack is unknown, can't be known.
He called himself in, right?
But he changed his mind.
He drove up to Kavanaugh's house and saw two armed marshals standing guard. So.
And had a change of heart. So
yeah,
but you know, I in no way am I defending that gentleman. No way. What he tried to do or thought about doing was wrong. But you know, on the other hand, the anti-abortion groups have often published the names and addresses and telephone numbers and the names of family members of abortion providers, which is how so many doctors have been murdered. So to single out that guy as being heinous, while true, he's not the only heinous person involved in this kind of violence within the abortion movement, anti and pro. So,
well, and that U-Haul van of militarists who were ready to attack the gay pride thing and. I forgot the name of the French name of the town, but
Coeur d'Alene.
Coeur d'Alene. Yeah. I mean, how can you imagine how that could have gone?
But you know what, Fred? Even more appalling is the number of threats that have been called into the police department in that town,
because other people intervened.
Yep. They are furious with the police for protecting 50%
of the calls coming in, threats to the police. That's awful.
And all this in Uvalde, and that's just kind of going by the, is it amazing how quickly it has to go on page 7 because there's all this other stuff happening.
Or Ukraine, who cares about Ukraine except today now? About more money, yeah, because you're hearing from Tom. Tom?
Well, I actually just talked to Tom. Tom's here, and Tom mentioned also that he felt that one of the things we should be doing is be giving more big equipment to Ukraine that they have been begging for, and how slow Germany has been in coming around. That's another topic, yes.
Maybe loading up some of those really big planes with grain and flying it out of there so that we don't have a full failure of food for the wide part of the world. It's disgusting what Russia is perpetrating.
I think that might be, if we can talk about this for a second after we go off air, let me share a little bit more with you about that. I would like to see. I know that. I understand the politics of this, but I really am not happy with Biden going to Saudi Arabia. I have a real thing about Saudi Arabia, and that visit, especially considering what he has said in the past, really, really concerns me. I know politically it's probably a very smart thing to do. I'm not that smart.
I don't think it's politically. He's doing it so that he can try to persuade the Saudis to pump more oil.
Well,
they ain't going to do it unless he dances the sword. Yeah.
But I'm furious as an American that American oil companies won't up their output. And yet they're making billions and billions of dollars in profit and buying back their stock. So they could also be part of the solution, and they refuse to be. Because I think a lot of corporations believe that Democratic-led governments are opposed to them.
Yeah, the cost of a barrel of oil right now is what it was when gasoline was $3.25. Is $1.18, $118 a barrel, and that's what. And so, where is that money going? It's in the hands of the stockholders.
Nick said he heard Putin pretty much laughing all the way to the bank, saying, "I'm not going to run out of money because people are buying oil at the prices that you described for it." So he's not going to give up because he's feeling pinched, at least governmentally. And Nick also said he heard that Putin asked one of his friends, supporters, whatever, to give him cash to buy arms. And whomever it was, I don't know if it was China or not, but whomever it was said, not on your life, you're not getting money for arms. So.
There are times I wish we had Planet B for me to move to. Unfortunately, we're stuck with this one, and I guess I'm not going anywhere soon.
Well, there are times when I wanted to help pay for your ticket, too, but it's a turn. I mean,
you're a generous guy. Well,
it's the least I could do, you know. Hey, we are just about out of time. How about anything that anybody wants to say about our gun pro? Go ahead, Ruth.
No, it's not about guns. I just wanted to give a shout out to Wood to Wonderful for making toys and making sure that they pocket-sized toys and sending them to Ukraine for children who have been displaced.
And a lot of them, thousands.
It's lovely.
Yeah. They do a reading program in the city, and for a couple of years I've been reading with them, and every month we go in to read, and every child in the class gets a copy of the book we've read and a toy that's been made by Wood to Wonderful. Hmm. So they do it locally as well as globally.
Neat.
So thank you, Louise.
Well, we are almost out of time now, but the recent spat of shootings and so on, we don't have nearly enough time to do it anything near justice now, but I'd like to initiate a conversation, if we could give it some thought, about I don't want to sound trite, but is there a culture of violence in this country? It seems to be something that is beyond the occasional nutcake going out and doing something heinous. I mean, there are... It really concerns me about what we've said, and I'm thinking, you know, I'm random now, but John talking about disrupting neighborhoods and stuff and the cohesiveness that comes with that, and there's just stuff going on, because in all, not to downplay in any way, shape, or form, but the mass shootings, which I think are defined as a shooting wherein at least three people have been shot. Is that correct, John?
Four, I think it's four.
Four, yeah. All right. Well, three or four, we'll say. Account to something like 2.6% of the shootings in this country. I mean, there are almost countless shootings going on in places like Chicago every weekend. And we are now going to have to leave that thought hanging for our audience to contemplate as we must say goodbye. So have a great weekend. We've got Father's Day, and I'm sorry, I got to pick a sore subject here. My birthday is always, it seems to be the day before Father's Day, and I get shafted. Here's your Father's Day birthday gift, and instead of getting two, I get one. So I'm a little bit sensitive about this, but Father's Day is this.
A child born on Christmas Day.
Yeah, same thing. So okay. This is Father's Day weekend, so have a good one, and we will look forward to seeing you next week.
And Juneteenth, too, on Sunday.
Indeed.
That's right. Okay.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.